Hello everyone. So today we're going to go over section 3.8, rates of change. So there are two kinds of rates of change we'll be looking at. The first one is the average rate of change. And the second will be the instantaneous rate of change. So, as we discussed previously, the average rate of change has to do with finding secant lines, whereas instantaneous rates of change are about finding tangent lines. So, suppose we have a function y equals f of x right here. And we're looking at two different x values. Let's call them x0 and x1. Okay, so the average rate of change would be the change in the y value divided by the change in the x value going from x0 to x1. So again, that it will be the slope of the secant. And that is delta y over delta x, which of course we can also write as, since y is equal to f of x 1 minus f of x naught divided by x1 minus x0. Okay. So, whereas the instantaneous rate of change, specifically at x0, it will be the tangent line. So, see in this case, this will be pretty much the tangent line. It's just an estimate, of course. Something like this. And that, of course, will be the slope of the tangent. And the difference is, of course, we're looking at dy dx instead of delta y delta x. Now, the form is a little bit similar. We still have f of x1 minus f of x0 divided by x1 minus x0. But we are really looking at the limit as x1 approaches x0. So we're really dealing with one value of x instead of two. And we know this is going to be the same as f prime of x0. So, since we're looking at rates of change, one of the ways that we can produce an example that is an application of the derivatives would be distance, time, and speed, and also acceleration. So if we let the displacement s of an object be a function of time, and that is to say, we have s equals to some f of t, okay, then delta s over delta t would be the average velocity. And of course, ds dt would be the instantaneous velocity. And this is going from, of course, some t0 to t1. And instantaneous velocity will be at t naught, since we know that we're looking at the limit as t1 approaches t naught. Okay, so let's look at a specific example of the difference between average velocity and instantaneous velocity. Suppose we have here s of t, so again, talking about the position of, in this case, a particle. So s is a function of time, and we have t cubed minus 6t squared plus 9t. So first part is that asking us what is the velocity of the particle at time t. So we know that just simply means to take the derivative, because the derivative of the rate of change of the position is the velocity. So we have v equals f prime of t, and that will simply be 3t squared minus 12t plus 9. Okay. So we can find the instantaneous velocity of the particle after 2 seconds or after 4 seconds simply by substituting in 2 and 4 respectively. So we have f prime of 2. So that would be 3, 2 squared, minus 12 times 2, plus 9, which of course will give us negative 3. It doesn't say what the units are, so we're just going to say units per second. And similarly, on the right, we have f prime of 4. So that will be 3 times 4 squared minus 12 times 4 plus 9. And that will give us 9 units per second. Okay, so now if we were to calculate the average velocity from 2 to 4 seconds, we will use the kind of the slope formula. We have delta s over delta t. So that of course means f of 4 minus f of 2 all over 4 minus 2. And of course that means you substitute 4 into the original function. So we have 4 cubed minus 6 times 4 squared plus 9 times 4, and then minus 2 cubed minus 6 times 2 squared plus 9 times 2, and this will be all over 4 minus 2, which of course is just 2. So after simplifying the numerator, you will get 2, and 2 divided by 2 will just give you 1 unit per second. So the average velocity in the same time frame of from 2 to 4 seconds is 1 unit per second. And next part, it asks, when is the particle at rest? So that means the velocity would have to be 0. So f prime of t is equal to 0. We already found what f prime of t was. It, of course, was 3t squared minus 12t plus 9 equals 0. So we can factor this expression here. Okay, first we'll factor out the 3, and then we can factor the trinomial that is left over. We'll get t minus 3 and t minus 1. So of course that tells us that the particle is at rest at t equals 3 seconds and t equals 1 second. So, since the displacement or the position of the particle was given as a polynomial, we know that it's going to be a smooth curve. So the changes in velocity and acceleration is not going to be abrupt, as in there's no gaps, no jumps in the derivatives. So it's asking us here, when is the particle moving forward? We can find intervals where the derivative is greater than 0. So again, we have a factored form already, so 3, and then t minus 3, t minus 1, and this time we're looking for it to be greater than 0. Of course, going back to our review of pre-calculus 12, we had set up a number line, and then we used the roots to make intervals. So here is 1 and 3. Okay, and then we just test values to see if the derivative is greater than 0 in each one. So here we have f prime of 0. So that, of course, is just 9, which is greater than 0. So this would be an interval where the particle is moving forward. And the second interval here, f prime of, let's say, 2. So if you substitute 2 into this expression here, you will get a negative value. In fact, you will get negative 3, which means the particle will be moving backwards. So this is a no-go. And in the third interval, we can just substitute any number that's greater than 3. So let's just say 4. And if you substitute 4s here, you'll get a positive number. F prime of 4, in fact, is equal to 9, and that's also greater than 0. So that interval is one where the particle is moving forward again. So the final answer will be when t is less than 1. Of course, it is greater than 0. And when t is greater than 3. Okay, so next up, we're going to look over the total distance traveled by the particle in the first 5 seconds. So we're not looking for the displacement. So the particle could be moving backwards or forwards, but all that distance counts. And so we use what we gathered from the last part of the question. There are three intervals. The first one, 0 to 1. The particle is moving forward, so we figure out what that distance is. And then from 1 to 3, the particle is moving backwards, so we find out what that distance is. And finally, from 3 to 5, 5 being the indicated endpoint, we find out what the distance travel in that interval is. The particle is moving forward, and then we just add the three of these together. So in this case, this would just be the distance in the first part is equal to the absolute value of f of 1 minus f of 0. Here, the second part, we have the absolute value of f of 3 minus, again, f of 1. And in the third part, we have the absolute value of f of 5 minus f of 3. So the numbers turns out to be 4, and then 4, and then 20 units in the third interval. So the total distance traveled is just going to be 28. Units. So, now we are to find the acceleration at time t and also after 4 seconds. Considering that the acceleration is the rate of change of the velocity, we are looking at the second derivative of the function f of t. So, Again, that's f double prime of t is the acceleration. And we already know what f prime of t was. F prime of t was 3t squared minus 12t plus 9. And then we just take this derivative, and we'll get 6t minus 12. Okay, so that will satisfy the first part, and that is to say, find the acceleration at time t. We have 6t minus 12 is the acceleration at time t. And then specifically, when t is equal to 4, we just substitute in 4. So we have 6 times 4 minus 12. So the acceleration at t equals 4 would be 12 units per second squared. Okay. So for the last part, we have the graphs of the position. That was the cubic function, that's the one that was in red. We have the first derivative, which gives us the velocity, that's in blue, which is a quadratic function. And finally, we took the second derivative, and that gave us acceleration. So, it asks us when is the particle speeding up and when is it slowing down. So, in order to do that, we need to know some general indicator when the particle is speeding up. So, a particle speeds up when the velocity and the acceleration are both positive or if they're both negative. So, imagine moving forward and accelerating forward. So that would mean you're speeding up, or moving backwards and accelerating backwards, that would also be speeding up, but kind of in reverse. And then the particles slow down when the velocity and acceleration are opposite. So, okay, so once again. Speed up. That is the velocity and acceleration. Both positive, so that would be speeding up going forward, and if they're both negative, that would be speeding up backwards. And here, slowing down. Oops. When they have opposite signs. Okay, so in this case, the interval is actually cut up very nicely. So we have t0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and... Oops, sorry. This is 3, 4, and 5. There we go. So if you look at each interval here, in the first part, from going from 0 to 1, the velocity is positive, but the acceleration is negative. So that means in this first interval, the particle is slowing down. Going from 1 to 2, both velocity and acceleration were negative. So this would be speed up. Going from 2 to 3, velocity is negative, so it's going backwards, but it is accelerating forward, so it is slowing down. And finally, from 3 seconds and beyond, both acceleration and velocity is positive, so it'll be speeding up. Okay. So that was a brief introduction into the relationship between position, velocity, and acceleration using derivatives. So next day we'll continue with another example on how to apply the techniques of differentiation for other word problems. But that's it for today, so thank you for listening.